He's a two-time Olympian, a multiple-time world and national champion, and the third American ever to wear the leader jersey at the Giro d'Italia. Please give it up for Taylor Phinney. Wow. He just finished up a GQ photo shoot. Looking great.
I woke up with this on.
I remember when we, oh my God, I better get a booster chair.
I'll get comfortable.
Nice. So I remember when we had Taylor at Endurance Awards when you were our junior cyclist year in 2008. During the middle of his speech, he says, "Hey, I know you triathletes think you're cool, but check this out." And he reaches down, pulls up his trousers, and he goes, "Camo, we're talking camo, camo tights here. Camo compression. You guys think you're cool. I got camo compression."
I don't wear compression socks anymore, though.
No more, huh? They're not cool anymore. So take us through that, Taylor. You got away with, what, about 7K to go?
Yeah, well, that was the last 1.5K. I was doing that for 6K before that also. But
And it was a 231-kilometer race.
245, actually.
245. And so you made the move with about 7K to go.
Yeah, so we had these finishing circuits that we did maybe 4 or 5 times, and I just saw there was one hill that if somebody wanted to get away, you could probably get away there. And just kind of saw the TV moto, and I was like, well, I'll go for it, and probably not going to work, but you know, at least my parents will be able to watch me on the live stream. The ultra high quality live stream that you guys just saw.
Yeah, that's pretty nice.
And then I got out there and I was like, you know, I'm going pretty fast and I feel pretty good. And had to commit at that point. And I had a radio in my ear telling me split times, and he was telling me I had like 20 seconds, 25 seconds at the most. And I was kind of doing the math thinking like, well, in theory, you could do this. It's just going to be really, really painful. And I don't know if you noticed, but when I come over that last hill, it's not really a hill, it felt like a hill. When I come over that last little bump, like before the finishing stretch, I'm like all twisted. When I get out of my saddle, that never happens to me. I like to, you know, look cool and composed.
Of course. Yeah.
But at that moment in time, I was very close to vomiting. but that's... That signifies that I was doing my job properly.
Nice.
As all of us endurance athletes know.
So I was just looking back, and it was just in September, you were at the World Time Trial Championships, correct? And I look at the, you know, Tony Martin wins it, and he averages, you know, 52.91 K per hour. And so it's like a Hall of Fame. It's got Tony Martin, Bradley Wiggins, Fabian Cancellara, you know, those guys are from there. Here's Taylor Phinney in fifth place. You 35-mile course. You average 31, a little over 31 miles an hour for 35 miles. How the hell do you do that? That's unbelievable.
I've been to a lot of wind tunnels.
Yeah.
So I have a fast position, even though I'm a very large human. And
what are you, 6'5"?
It was, yeah, 6'5 and a quarter.
Thank you. 6'5 and a quarter. And so that must upset when you're in these races.
There's a chick in the back who just shook her head when I did. She's like,
he's not 6'5". He's
loser.
Nice. And you weigh what?
Well, it's December, so we don't really ask that question.
Oh, that's right. Good point. Okay. What would
December.
You weigh if this was July?
I'm about like 190 now on a good day.
Yeah.
You know, good day. And then in July, I'd be like 182, 183. But I'm just a big person.
You are a big person. So, but you're in a sport that a lot of times it's beneficial, especially with these mountain things, to not be that big.
To not be big.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So does it get frustrating sometime when you're out there and you're...
Yeah. I mean, get dropped a lot when I go uphill. But, you know, I make it back on the downhills. through sheer speed
yes.
and power. And I have a watt per kilo benefit when I'm only when I'm going downhill, but then I can just rip the legs off those little guys.
All those little those little climber guys.
Unless they're in my draft, and then they're basically not pedaling, and I'm just like, like, I'm killing these guys.
And then they're right there, they're eating a sandwich. Yeah.
Chris Horner's just like all sideways, not breathing behind me.
Nice. Thanks for the pull. I like that.
Yeah.
So growing up, take us back. What were your sports growing up?
I played soccer religiously when I was a kid, from when I was like 4 until I was 15.
In Boulder?
Yeah, in Boulder. And then my family and I, we moved to Italy when I was 12. And we lived in Italy for 3 years. And I realized then that I was not a very good soccer player.
You thought you were pretty good when you were here, though. You were pretty good when you were in Boulder, though.
When I was like 8 years old, I scored a lot of goals.
Yeah.
And, I was the striker. I was the clutch performer of my 8-year-old soccer team. And then I went to Italy. I got a bit of a reality check, started riding my bike, and I was like, hey, my parents do this, and I could probably be pretty good at this, too. So
speaking of that, mom, Olympic gold medalist, 1984 in the road race. Dad, bronze medalist. Dad, the cash register, won every criterium that has ever been created. And so knowing, when did you get a sense of the fact that your parents were great athletes?
That's an interesting question. I always kind of knew about their Olympic success because, like, whenever I would have show and tell as a child, I'd be like, trump card.
Gold medal, bronze medal.
Somebody be like, here's my pet monkey. I'm like, Olympic gold medal. So I always knew about, their Olympic success, but I didn't really have a grasp on it because I was playing soccer and, my parents ran bike camps and, so I knew what cycling was, and I always rode a bike, but I didn't really understand, what racing a bike was necessarily as a kid. And my parents didn't really push much on me. My dad kind of got too involved in, like, my soccer when I was an 8-year-old and realized that that was ridiculous, and then decided that he would just pull out and let me kind of decide what I wanted to do. So, it sounds weird, but I sort of found cycling by myself.
Yeah.
And, I had a lot of help because I never had to buy a bike or...
There's a few laying around.
Learn how to ride a bike. But I'd just go out and I was kind of like, hey, I really like this. I really like the time that I get to spend with my dad, riding in Italy when we were living there. And then I just said, hey, when we move back to the States, it'd be kind of cool to race. So... Yeah.
So were you 15-ish, 16 when you started racing?
Yeah, I was 15.
And I think you won like 20 races or something that first year.
Yeah, but they were like category 3 races. And
but you were brand new. Yeah.
And like junior race. Like the first race, I was, people asked me like, what place did you get in the first race that you competed in? I'm like, well, I won. But there were like 7 people in the race. So...
But you weren't 7th.
No, I wasn't 7th, but there were just 7 16-year-olds in the race. So it's not like I went to, it's not like I just jumped into the Tour de France and I was like, yeah, I'm gonna win now.
Yeah, but pretty much. I remember when you came out here and you were up in L.A. and playing at the beach. Next thing, Roger Young goes, hey, why don't
you... But the track is different.
Okay, so the track is different. Okay, so you go to the track... I remember Roger calling me after the first time you're on the track going, I think Taylor's going to break like the track record in his second or third time out here. You had success right away on the track.
Yeah, I think my mom was a track racer back in the day, as well as being a road racer. My dad was a big crit guy, so like short couple minute efforts for me are sort of my strong suit. So I just jumped on the track and loved it, because you're going around in a circle on like 45 degree bankings, and that's fun to begin with. And then that's kind of like my true calling would be the track. But then they took my event out of the Olympics.
I know. So from the first time you got on the track to qualifying for the Olympics, how long a period of time was that? It wasn't that long.
I got on the track probably around this time. I got on the track in September.
Something like that.
Of 2007. And then went to my first World Cup in the end of November.
2 months, okay, yeah. So you're a slow learner.
Actually, the first World Cup that I went to, we got there and my bike broke. So I had to jump on somebody else's bike that I'd never ridden before, like completely different position, the day before the race, a World Cup. I was kind of like, roll the dice. Let's do it. And it was Magnus Backstead's bike, who's also a giant human. I don't know. It'd be nice to be, you know, that young and stupid, but also, I guess naive, sort of. Like, you're just like, I'll just jump on somebody else's bike and get ninth in a World Cup. That's no big deal.
No big deal.
And then just fly to China 2 days later and be like 6 seconds faster. I mean, I don't know. The track was just kind of a natural thing for me.
And so really, like, you got into it in 07, and in 08, you're on the Olympic team.
Yeah, it was a long process to make the Olympic team. It was not easy. I had to go to all the World Cups, which there were five of, traveled all around the world. They're not like, all in America.
Right.
I had to go to South Africa, Europe, China, Australia. I mean, really all over the place. And then only qualified sort of at the last moment at the World Championships, which were in March. So it was a long, from September to March, I was pretty much traveling and also going to high school.
At the same time.
At the same time, yeah.
And you qualified for the Olympics and went to Beijing. What was that experience like?
Beijing was interesting. I mean, it was really cool in the sense that I went there and I got to go to the opening ceremonies, and then we had a week until our events, and so we got to experience the village a bit, and I ended up staying after the events for the whole time. So I was in the village for 3 weeks, and I went to opening ceremonies and closing ceremonies. I like fell in love with the gymnast. Olympic experience.
Yeah.
I was too young for it and too immature for it.
18 years old.
Yeah, I just turned 18. I just graduated high school, and I was like, I've worked this whole year, which that sounds stupid. I've worked a year to get to the Olympics, but I've worked really hard to get here. And once I made it, I was kind of content with the fact that I made it, instead of being there like, okay, now game on. Let's see what else I can do. So I got there and was just really distracted, basically, by
gymnasts.
Well, yeah, we're saying. I mean, it's a really different environment than you would imagine. I mean, you spend even when I went this last year, you spend all this time being really conscious of what you eat and how you sleep and how you train, and then you go into this place that is basically like a college. You're basically staying in like a college dormitory with every other athlete on the planet who are all tapering into this event, to where everybody's testosterone is like way up here and everybody's all excited and ready to race. You have some athletes that finish like on day one and then they're just like in party mode, and you have other athletes that are there that are trying to be serious. And then you have like a McDonald's in the food cafeteria. You have every single item of food that you could eat. And so you get there and it's just like culture shock. You're just kind of like, you've been sort of living this like monk lifestyle, like trying to get there. And then you get there and you're like, this is the coolest place ever. I need to like, you know, milk everything I can from this experience, because it's not gonna happen for another 4 years if I'm lucky. And so that was kind of how I was in 2008, and I changed that drastically in 2012.
You mentioned a little earlier that you know, the track was meant for you. Short, hard races, intense, but the Olympic Committee basically got rid of your events on the track, right?
Yeah, well,
individual pursuit?
In 2008, there was definitely some gender disparities in the track events, to where there were only 3 events for the women and there were 7 events for men.
Right.
So they wanted to bring that to 5 and 5, but the way that they brought it was to introduce more sprint events, which are really short, like, 10 seconds or 10 to 45 seconds, you know, because those are more exciting to watch and, you know, a little bit more, obviously more explosive, and better for TV ratings, I guess.
Right.
So, they did that and they took my event out, and it was kind of, it's kind of like being broken up with, sort of, you know,
sure.
But reading about it on the internet.
It's like basically you got like, email saying,
yeah,
we're dumping you.
It's like I was dating Kim Kardashian or something, and I like opened up like E! Online, and it was like Kim Kardashian and Kanye West, and I'm like, no. sort of like that.
Somehow like that.
No, but you know, you get over these things, and I wanted to make a transition to the road anyways, from the track, and I just thought, well, I'm gonna need to do that sooner than I would have thought, which, you know, it's working out pretty well.
When did you feel that you could make a living in the sport?
Pretty much when I qualified for the Olympics, went to the Olympics, and then had the decision to either go to college or pursue bike riding. In my mind, there wasn't, you know, doing both. It was one or the other. And, just having the opportunity to have a salary and sign a, you know, 2 to 3 year deal as an 18-year-old, I was like, well, I could either go into a lot of debt right now and do a lot of partying, or I could ride my bike professionally and make a fair amount of money and, you know, deal with the whole college education thing later. So that was kind of when it hit me. But kids, go to school.
Talk about some of your first pro races where you're racing against, you know, like we just talked about, some of these legends. You're racing against some of the big name guys who are in all the magazines, and now you're the new kid.
Yeah, it's still actually a little bit weird for me racing with these guys, because I still do, you know, we all, when we're not at races, we watch races. I haven't done the Tour de France yet, so, you know, I watch the Tour de France every year. I love watching it. I'm a fan of the sport as well as a, you know, participant.
Yeah.
And, it's definitely weird racing with guys like Cancellara, who's somebody that I've really looked up to for a long time, and Wiggins, and these guys. But you just kind of, you gain confidence. When I came in, I had like blind confidence of, like a young guy who didn't care. And then I've quickly realized maybe 5 stages into my first race that I was not gonna be able to be like that without being completely hated. So then I turned into like an ultra nice guy, and now I'm trying to figure out where the balance is between ultra nice and like, a-hole.
Somewhere
because,
in between.
No,
ultra-a-hole?
It's a difficult balance, like, in sport, because you get that to where, you have to be selfish, and you have to be, when it gets down to it, at least in a bike race, and you're throwing elbows and you're getting dirty, you're, like, not a great human. You're not a very nice person. So I like to be nice a lot of the time, most of the time, and I'm trying to find that balance to where it's okay for me to be, you know, not so nice here, but then I'll be nice most of the time to make up for it.
Did you find these guys?
It's my cross to bear.
Exactly. So guys like Conchalar and Wiggins, they've been nice guys, speaking of nice?
Yeah.
Accepting?
No, they are, but they've definitely found that balance. You know, I think when Conchalar is one of the more selfish riders that I know, but he's very successful, and so it's okay for him to be selfish within his team structure, and it's the same with Wiggins, it's the same with all these guys. So it's a combination of being strong enough and being confident enough to be that selfish and then also balancing it out. But at least when they get off the bike, like Mark Cavendish is a great example, because when he's on the bike, he is a fiery dude. He can be very mean on the bike, but he gets off the bike and he is the nicest little man you've ever met. He's one of my favorite people. I spent a lot of time with Kev, and he's one of my favorite human beings on the planet. But when he gets on his bike, it's just like, just that's off to the side.
He's going to work.
And he wins races, you know, and he's successful, and that's what he needs to do to be there. But it's just a weird thing that, you know, you wouldn't really necessarily think. I wouldn't have thought about coming into the sport, like that kind of balance, you know.
So how old were you when you realized that, you know, your dad, Davis Phinney, that something was not quite right, that, you know, you probably didn't know right away what it was, but he just seemed different?
Well, I was 10 when he was diagnosed with Parkinson's disease, so it's not like it was, you know, it's not like my parents sat me down and I was, like, fully cognizant of what that was.
Sure.
For me, it basically just meant that he was going to be spending more time at home, so I was like,
that's good.
Sweet. I love hanging out with Dad.
Yeah.
So it's something that I've grown up with and not necessarily something that, you know, that, like, hit me really hard at a certain age. But it is, you know, I rode this group ride yesterday, the Swami's group ride. I don't know if you guys...
You guys have ridden on that. There we go. Yeah. Those are the really slow guys in San Diego.
Yeah. And I smashed them.
Did you smash them?
And a quick side story. And my electronic shifting was, my battery was dead, so my front derailleur didn't work, so I was just in the little ring the whole time, which just added so much insult to injury. It was great.
So you're just spinning away from these guys.
So there was a guy on the ride. His name is Thurlow Rogers.
Oh, yeah. Legend.
Legend. He was on the Olympic team with my dad in 1984. And he goes.
Still.
And I was just thinking, you know, this morning and yesterday, like, that would be my dad, you know? That would definitely be my dad. And so it's hard for me to think about that, you know, because I know that he would love to be out there. He's, you know, he rides, but he can't ride like that. He can't go out there and kick people's asses.
Like he used to.
So I know that's, you know, that's difficult for him. And it's also, you know, hard for the people that love him to see him not be able to do that. But he does live a very fulfilling life, and my mom takes good care of him, and, you know, he laughs a lot and has a good good time with most of what he's doing. So, you know, he's not one to complain, but it would be nice to see him at full strength.
One of my favorite moments with you and your dad, I think it was in Mexico, and I think it was, the Junior World time trial? I can't remember. Run the roads.
Probably, yeah.
On the roads, and your dad was in the back seat of the car, and I don't think you were considered a favorite to win this thing, but you were winning it.
No, that's a good video that you should show.
We should. Dad's in the back, basically going, he's going to effing win.
Yeah.
He's going out of his mind.
There were a couple times when I was a kid when I would do something really stupid, and he'd get really mad at me and swear like that.
Yeah.
But I've never heard my dad swear so much in a video, and it's on YouTube. It's so funny because it's from the car. It's like, oh, he's gonna effing win the world championships. Taylor's going to be world champion. Just freaking out. I mean, junior world champion doesn't like mean so much, but it was, he got so excited.
When we were interviewing Davis, and one of the stories he tells is when he was doing a tour and Tour de France, and he was having a really bad day. And to stay in the tour, he had to make the cutoff time, but he was basically behind everybody in the peloton, riding on his own. They're closing the roads, and you know, he's sort of riding along. And he ends up collapsing at the finish and makes a cutoff time by 2 minutes or something like that.
Yeah, it was the Alpe d'Huez stage, I think.
Yeah. So you had something like that not long ago, right?
I did. I do know how that feels. I had this stage in a race called Tirreno Adriatico, which is a week-long stage race in Italy in March. It was the second to last stage. There was a time trial on the last day. I'd been targeting this time trial, so wanted to make it through this stage, but just started off the day. It was 230K, and it was in...
It's freezing too, right?
Well, it was really nice at the start of the day. It was sunny and warm. The whole race had been terrible. It snowed, it was rainy, and this race is known for its long days, so it'll be like 5-6 hours in just rain and like 40 degrees, and you're just like... So miserable.
And 27% grades. Really,
yeah,
steep
and so
climbs.
Well, so this last stage was just I forget what the region is called in Italy, but it's like southeast of Tuscany, and they specialize in all these tiny little short like 1 kilometer climbs that are like 20 to get up to 33% was the one before the finish. So the race organizers just wanted to make this stage like as hard as they possibly could make it. So they made us do 2 90-kilometer loops and then like a smaller like 40-kilometer loop or 50-kilometer loop. So we do the first lap and I'm off the back with a bike mechanical problem like right from the start and everybody's attacking just going apeshit, and I'm like off the back and like trying to go up these terrible little climbs, and I'm tired. It's the the seventh day of the race, and I'm not making it back on. And I had a teammate helping me who would actually pace me back up, and then I would get dropped, and then he would pace me back up, and then I would get dropped. And we got to 90K. We got to right before the finish line for the first time, passing it for the first time, and a group had formed in the back. Commonly known as the Gruppetto,
right.
With Cavendish and all the other sprinter bigger guys, and so I was like, all right, great, now we have like 30, 40 of us, we're gonna make it to the finish. I'm gonna be able to do the time trial tomorrow. I'm not looking forward to the second lap, but we're gonna get it done as a group and go slow. But the only problem was that when we passed the finish line, all the team buses are there, and that's like. Passing your house. If you go out and do like an hour in the snow and then you'll pass your house, you're like, I'm probably gonna stop now and cook some bacon. So we get there and, well, actually before we got there, I was kind of talking to the guys like, all right, this is gonna suck, but we're gonna do it, right? We're gonna do it. And everybody's like, no, man, it's time trial tomorrow. I don't do time trials. I'm like, I do, though, so we could all, do this because we do this all the time. Like, nah, no. And so, seriously, we go through the finish line, and there's, 43 of us. 42 people stop. Just, broop, into the bus, I can already hear them in the shower as I'm riding away. And I'm just like, ah, shit. So now I have 130K to go and I'm by myself and I'm 10 minutes off the back, not going as fast as the group, so I'm just losing time. And right at that moment, right as I pass the finish line, it starts to rain. So it's not really warm to begin with. It was just clear. It was clear. And then when it starts to rain, you obviously get wet and cold. So I'm going, and at first it was kind of like, yeah, I'm a badass, like I'm gonna do this. And maybe like 20 kilometers later, I was like, this is the dumbest thing I've ever decided that I'm gonna do. But as I kept going, and as I sort of kept going, you know, just like, because it's easy to keep going. It's really hard to stop. It's really hard to get off your bike, clip out, and like quit. So it's easy just to keep pedaling. And so I was going, and it turned more into this sort of, not like spiritual quest, but it was just kind of like, I started to think a lot, you know, because you have a lot of time by yourself. I started to think a lot about my dad, and I was thinking like about that story, about stories that he would tell me, you know, when I was a kid, or stories that he would tell groups of people about, you know, being behind a race by himself and finishing by himself. And I was thinking like, if my dad was in my shoes and if he was healthy, you know, he would trade one day of living with Parkinson's disease for my, you know, shitty day out the back by myself in the rain in Tirreno Adriatico, but completely healthy, you know. So I started to think about that, and that started to push me and motivate me, and may or may not have shed a couple tears along the way. I had a guy in the follow car behind me, Fabio Baldato, who was a team director, who kept trying to get me to hang on the car and like kept telling me to have all the fans like push me up the hills, but I was just being stubborn, and all these Italians would be like, die, 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 and they would like come and like try to give me a hand, like push me up these, you know, stupid 30% grades, and I'd be like, no, no, I will do this for my father's honor. But really though, and yeah, it just turned into this thing to where, you know, did the lap and did the smaller lap where we covered some more of the climbs that we had done before. And so the fans were still there. Most were like walking away, but they would recognize me and, you know, Phinney, Phinney, you know, like he's still here. And and then would try to push me, like, no, screw you. No, just kidding, I don't know. Actually, some of the Italians, they, for whatever reason, I think that I have an L in my name, so they call me Finley. Like, Finley, Finley.
You can do it.
But, no, anyways, but I, you know, I know that feeling of, I remember coming down this one of the last descents, and I look off to the left, and I just see this massive, like, line of traffic, like, on this switchbacky road. I'm like, oh, man, that really sucks for those people. And then I get down to the bottom, and I'm like, oh, that's for me. I'm causing that.
Did you get last?
So basically, I ended up, the time cut was like 32 minutes, and I got there 34 minutes behind. But, you know, it was more about having done it, and it was more about, you know, just kind of showing myself that, you know, just that I'm gonna not take my body for granted. And I'm not going to take, you know, time for granted. And, you know, I have this opportunity, even if I am going to be last in a bike race and finish 2 minutes outside the time cut and maybe shed a couple tears, you know, I'm still going to do it because I have this, you know, the gift of just being healthy. Right. That was what really stuck with me. And then I ended up, the next weekend, I ended up getting seventh in Milan-San Remo in similar conditions. So it wasn't all for, you know, it wasn't time wasted. But
so talk a little bit about, there's only been two Americans before you who have worn the pink jersey of the Giro d'Italia. So the winning the prologue there. What was that like? That's legendary, right? I mean, it's Andy Hampston, it's Christian Vandeveld, and I think that's sort of it, and Taylor Phinney.
Yeah, but different kind of rider than they are, but it was really cool to win the first stage and get in the jersey. From that moment on, it was like incredibly stressful because I went to bed for 3 nights in a row and woke up, you know, 3 mornings in a row like, shit. All I can do today is lose this jersey somehow. It's a good day if I don't lose this jersey. So that's my goal. And I crashed like 3 days in a row with the jersey and like made these dramatic comebacks like in the final kilometers of the race.
Yeah.
But it was, you know, it was interesting also because it was in Denmark. The Giro, the Tour of Italy started in Denmark that year.
A little strange.
As you do. It starts in Ireland next year, so they're into that. It was great. I like pink. I ended up having, I don't like pink, but I like pink. but I got like, you know, like a pink accented bike and had these pink accented shoes and a massive pink helmet, which is not something I should have just said. But So it was fun. You know, I like to color coordinate, and that was my favorite part. That was my favorite part of the whole deal, but it was an honor, you know, to be among those couple dudes.
So, like you said, you went to Beijing, sort of like, okay, I made it here, let's enjoy every minute of it. Now, 2012, you get to London, road race and time trial. Was the attitude different when you went there in terms of what you were looking to accomplish?
Yeah, for sure. So, one, did not go to opening ceremonies.
No gymnasts?
Because it's like, well, when I was there in 2008, I was 18, and the gymnasts, you know, were like 16, 17.
Yeah.
But when you go as like a 22-year-old.
Yeah, that's not good.
And then the gymnasts are still like 16, 17.
They don't ever age.
You're like, yeah, probably stay away from that. Or will I? No. bad. Anyways, we stayed outside of the village, so I didn't even meet any gymnasts. We did not go to opening ceremonies, like I said. Stayed outside the village until 2 nights prior. Still had a couple McDonald's milkshakes the night before the race, which was irresponsible, but it was like the height of my irresponsibility. During that Olympics.
So that was it.
But
that
it
was
is only hard. I mean, like, we stayed outside, and then it was like, you get into the village, and all of a sudden you're just like, and then you're just like, 48 hours. I only have 48 hours of this. Just, like, stay in your hot dorm room with your roommate, and just don't go outside. And it worked out better.
So you got fourth in the time trial and fourth in the road race.
Yeah, fourth in the road race, which was cool, but also slightly heartbreaking because, you know, it's like I remember doing the sprint for third place and just like, that's a bronze medal right in front of me. Just right there is a bronze medal, and I'm not going to get it.
Ugh.
And so it was, yeah, I did a little like, little cry thing afterwards, but I don't cry that much.
Olympics is okay. Olympics is okay when you
keep talking about crying in front of you guys. You just really bring it out of me, you know.
So for our triathlon folks here, growing up in Boulder and your dad's good buddies with Dave Scott and
lots of tri geeks,
right?
Boulder.
Ride with many of those guys over the years? I know, did you and
not really.
You and your dad, did you ever ride with Dave's son?
Yeah, Drew?
Yeah.
Yes, I've ridden with Drew, he's very strong, he's a cool guy.
Did Dave try to drop you when you guys rode?
No, not that I remember. Maybe he tried and I just didn't notice.
That's what I was hoping for. That was good. I like that. Yeah, he's sort of like a fly.
No, I've ridden with Matty Reed a couple times.
Yeah.
He's out here now.
He must love riding with you. Someone he can draft on.
He is a big unit as
well.
Yes,
he is. Yes. He's living here now.
Yes, I saw him a couple days ago. You know, there's a select group of triathletes that I hang out with.
Did growing up in Italy, did that make it easier for you to handle being a pro cyclist and traveling the world with languages and all the rest of that?
A little bit. I mean, I would say that English is the primary language spoken in the peloton, and then Italian is kind of the second secondary language. So that's great because, you know, I'm friends with all the Italians, which is really nice, and Italians don't really like people that are different than them. So the fact that I speak Italian, like an Italian, you know, is great. And there's a lot of Italians in the peloton. So it just kind of extends my friend base.
Right.
Kind of doubles it.
So it doubles it.
Maybe more than double, because there's more Italians.
Paris-Roubaix, it seems like a race that would be made for you. That's a big guy race, right? It's a power race. You got to be strong to ride the cobbles. Is that one of your goals to win that?
Yeah, that's definitely a goal. It's one of the only races without any hills in it. So power to weight. And yeah, cobbles. Nobody really loves cobbles, but some people are you know, accepting of them more than others. So I love Paris-Roubaix because it's an incredibly dramatic race. You're never going to watch a boring Paris-Roubaix. That's just not going to happen. Because of all the carnage and dust and if it's, you know, hopefully you're not part of the carnage, but watch it from the side. But if it's wet, you know, it's everybody's muddy and dirty and, you know, you do the muddy buddy stuff, you know, it's how important it is to get dirty sometimes.
Of course.
It's just a race with a lot of history and also kind of characteristically suits me really well, so.
So when you look towards this season, you mentioned Tour de France. You're going to try to get to do the tour this year. What is it about that race? A lot of times guys go to the tour for the first time and it's, hey, I'm going to try to get through the opening couple weeks, and when it starts going to the mountains, get the heck out. What are your thoughts towards the tour?
Yeah, well, it's so difficult just to make the Tour de France team nowadays.
Yeah.
On any team that you're on, that it's you know, nobody really goes there to try to make it, you know, halfway or anything. You would go to, like, the Giro or the Vuelta to do that.
Yeah.
And so I haven't been – I've been a pro for 3 years. This will be my fourth year, actually, upcoming, and I haven't done the Tour de France yet. So I'm on the long list of 14. 9 guys get to go. So, you know, I'll be working quite hard to just make it there and be able to help TJ before the mountains.
Yes. Before the mountains. I love it.
And I'll be like, ciao.
Speaking of TJ and yourself, obviously we're in a different era of cycling, trying to move past the doping era. I know that you've been, from the very beginning, you've been very outspoken about, you know, not taking caffeine, not using anti-inflammatories, different types of things like that. As someone who's representing future of cycling, what are your goals, and how do you talk to the other guys at the peloton to make sure that cycling gets back the trust?
How it gets back the trust is just that's just a time issue. For me, I was always the thing that I loved about sport when I got into endurance sports was it was like, how far could I push my body to its natural ability? That's what I loved about endurance sports. That's what I love about cycling. And so you throw drugs into the mix in there, and that just takes away, you know, half of the love that I feel for the sport in general. And so that's why I'm pretty anti painkiller. I don't, you know, there's a lot of lot of tablets that people take nowadays, which, you know, in the scheme of things is a lot better than, you know, EPO and
right.
and blood bags
and all the rest of that
shit
sure.
like that. But, you know, it still is something that you are clinging on to, that you're like, I need to take this in order to feel better. And it's kind of, for me, it seems sort of like a gateway to doing other things. So I've been pretty outspoken about kind of eradicating all of that. I think we have a great, you know, we have a terrible reputation as a sport from people very removed.
Yes.
But if you know the sport, you do know what kind of an effort it goes through to keep itself clean. And for me, I feel very fortunate to have come into the sport at this time to where I can be competitive and do things, you know, like I did in Poland, you know, just off having a gel like 20 minutes before that. And, you know, there's a lot of other major sports, you know, they might be more unionized and they might protect their athletes better and have a better reputation, but I don't think that that is a positive thing for those sports, because they protect themselves and they allow themselves to do things that may or may not be legal, whereas we're kind of like an open book. You know, you can just come in and read our history.
That's right there.
On Wikipedia. And so for me, that's good. If we have to deal with a bad reputation for a while, that's fine, as long as the sport is staying clean and I'm able to continue racing clean. And yeah, it's sucks and it's kind of stupid that you know, we have to talk about it so much.
I know.
But just the way it is, you know.
Best race you've ever had?
Probably that Poland one.
Yeah.
I've always wanted to win a stage like that, you know, just kind of dangling out in front of a massive group of dudes. For, so that sounds weird, but.
That's pretty good line.
Foiling the sprinters is what I mean. You know, to where the sprinters are like, all right, we're getting ready for a sprint. And then it's like, who's that guy? And then it's like, me.
How about a round of applause for Mr. Taylor Phinney?